Are you also tired of one-size-fits-all weight loss plans? Meet Noom, the personalized solution that meets you where you are. Noom is able to understand your unique needs, from dietary restrictions to medical concerns. Unlike restrictive programs, Noom embraces your lifestyle and choices. Discover a sustainable approach to weight loss, tailored just for you. Honestly, Noom felt like it was made for me. It's not just about what I eat, it's about understanding why. With Noom, I've learned so much about myself and built healthier habits that stick. It's all about progress, not perfection. Say goodbye to restrictive diets and experience the Noom app for yourself with personalized lessons and expert coaching. Noom's psychology and biology-based approach has helped over 5.2 million people achieve their goals. Stay focused on what's important to you with Noom's psychology and biology-based approach. Sign up for your trial today at Noom.com. That's Noom.com. And check out Noom's first ever cookbook, The Noom Kitchen, for 100 healthy and delicious recipes to promote better living. Available to buy now wherever books are sold.
This is Kara Mayer Robinson. This is Really Famous, where I invite super talented, dynamic people to sit down and have a real conversation so I can get a feel for who they really are and what they really think. Sometimes it's like two old friends getting together over coffee. Other times it's like listening into a therapy session. My guest today is Mario Van Peebles. Mario is an accomplished actor, director, writer, and producer. If you've seen anything on TV recently, chances are Mario had a hand in it. For example, Empire, Bloodline, Nashville. You may also know him from Damages, Ali, 21 Jump Street, and New Jack City, which he directed as well as starred in. We recorded the first part of this interview earlier this year when I was in Los Angeles. And then last week, I caught up with Mario in New York. He invited me to the world premiere of his new action film, Armed, which he wrote, directed, and produced as well as stars in. And the next day, we caught up at his hotel to chat about, oh, this, that, and the other thing. And you'll hear that too. But first, I want to welcome younger fans. It looks like my interview with Peter Herman introduced a lot of you to Really Famous, and to all of you who came on board to listen to Peter and then kept listening to old episodes and are still listening, welcome and thank you for the major love you've been giving on social media. I so appreciate you reaching out, saying hi to me, giving me amazing feedback, going back and catching up on the previous episodes, recommending Really Famous on social media, leaving ratings and reviews, and telling your friends to listen. It is huge to me. It makes a big, big difference because I'm trying to grow the show, and this is totally the way to do it. It helps tremendously. And of course, non-younger fans, you know I love you too and appreciate all of your support beyond. So thank you to everybody, everyone who's listening, and please keep it coming. I also have a message for you from our sponsor, BetterHelp. BetterHelp is the largest online counseling service in the world. The cool thing about BetterHelp is it's online. You can do it through text, you can do it through video chat, you can do it through email or online. The choice is really yours, and it's all included for a monthly fee. If you're thinking about therapy, but you're not really sure where to start, you don't know how to get a therapist that's right for you, or maybe you're just kind of thinking, it all seems like too much. Well, BetterHelp can make it easier. And good news, BetterHelp is giving Really Famous listeners a free week of therapy. So to get the deal, go to betterhelp.com/reallyfamous. Here we are, Mario Van Peebles and me.
My life has been crazy beyond. It's like, so I'm so far past my bucket list that it's weird.
Like, what were your bucket list things?
You know, the bucket list, make mom and dad proud. I've done that. Have some really cool kids. Don't piss anybody off. I've done that. I don't have any real enemies that I want to hurt, or any people that seem to want to hurt me. That's cool. So yeah. I never did, you know, I never did drugs or slept with anyone or did anything that I didn't want to do. If I did something, it's because I wanted to do it. But not on any stupid manipulation, sell your soul to get here and do that kind of, none of that was necessary for me. I worked hard. I did sleep on a kitchen floor for 3 months that turned into 3 years.
When was this?
When I first got to LA, and I just kept the overhead low. But I'm an old soul, so I've never been a materialistic cat. I have an old car that I got used. It's my only car. It's a hybrid. It's sort of good for the planet. And I'm just not super materialistic, so that's always
helps.
It helps because then you can do the work you want to do. There's a line in life, see, and on one side is doing the things you want to do, and on the other side is having the things you want to have. So if you're more into I want shiny toys and shiny houses and shiny stuff, on some young soul stuff, then you're going to spend more of your energy making money or trying to make money to own things. If you're more on the do stuff, you're going to spend more of your energy and time doing things. So I sent my kids to good colleges, and I've traveled. We lived in Costa Rica, and I've done the movies and the TV shows I wanted. When I did Badass, and I played my dad, and I put the financing together with Jerry Offsay, and it got best screenplay, best director nominations, best feature nomination, and it got Ebert Roper's best movie of the year. And I did it in 18 days. We sold it to Sony Classics. That was like, cool. And you're playing your dad.
Yeah.
How cool is that? But more than that, my dad saw the movie, because he didn't come back. He just sold me the rights to his book. It's based on his book. And he sold me the rights for $1 and said, my only note is don't make me too fucking nice.
Okay.
That was it. He's my only note. And then he saw the movie in Toronto. And he sat there. It was a full house. People stood up at the end loving it. And he turned to me and he goes, this shit is like Seabiscuit on two legs. And I was like, I got to give you...
Seabiscuit on two legs.
Yeah, so that was his quote. I was like, to play your dad and let him see what you saw. What a kick.
Yeah, life is good.
How dope is that? And my dad, when he was in France, had interviewed. My dad learned French, went to France, learned French, became a reporter. He's an amazing guy.
Okay, I don't think I knew he was a reporter first.
He was a reporter.
Can we just back up a second?
Yeah,
so I read that you were born in Mexico City.
Born in Mexico City.
So what was the situation there?
Okay, so basically my dad was in the Air Force. One of the first black officers in the Air Force. And they frowned on interracial relationships at that time. My mom and him were dating. And
your mom is what?
My mom is as white as they get. I could use my mom as a reflector board. Okay. My mom, I have her sit next to me when we get sun so I could get some radiant, some more light. I just lay under my lap, Mom. She's got John, McCain type skin,
So it's a little pinkish?
She's white, dude.
And she has blonde, blue eyes.
Okay. And my dad is black, like the color of my jacket. So I grew up thinking people were light and dark and fat and skinny and blonde and brunette. Just like I didn't play with the color lines a lot because we lived in Europe.
Where in Europe? Where?
I'll go to that.
Okay.
You want to go to you? Stop. I got to go through chronologically, and then we'll get back to Paris because it's around in the, but it's worth the trip. So stay with me.
I'm happy to be on the trip. Believe me.
So my dad is in the Air Force when the first black officers, and every day that he goes to the officers' club, they arrest him for nigger impersonating an officer. Now they know who he is, but they still arrest him because they don't like the idea of him being an officer. My mother comes to stay with him on the base. They're like, what the hell? And they tell everyone they're cousins. My mother gets a real kick out of this, telling everyone they're cousins. They're like, this white chick is not his cousin, okay? No way. So she has her father write a letter to her saying, give Cousin Mel a big hug and a kiss for us. Right, and she knew that they were censoring his mail. So they're censoring his mail. They go, God damn, give Cousin Mel. This is from her parents. Because her parents were real cool. My dad's parents on the black side, my black grandmother was a little uptight about her being white. So they would go in the pool together and splash around. This white guy, white chick and this black guy in this late 50s, right? And all that cousin thing was working out well until I started to come along.
Okay.
And then my dad's like, we got to get out of here. this cousin shit is not going to fly.
Then that would be a real problem. Yeah. That would be another problem.
Luckily, his term of duty was up, but they wanted him to, he was a navigator of real value. Like, he was really good because he's an astrologer. He's really good with math. And I'm
so super smart.
Super smart. On like a number of levels. And so they wanted him to re-up. He said, this is dangerous. They're going to try to re-up me. Let's get across the border. And so they got across the border. And I was born in Mexico, hence the name Mario.
Oh, they named you Mario because of that?
Yeah, I got it. Well, it's an M name. My mother's Maria, my dad's Melvin. So they're like, stay with the M's. M's a good name. It's a good start, way to start in life with a good M. And then we went to San Francisco, where my dad became a cable car driver and then wrote a book on cable car driving. And decided, someone said, you know, a book is like a movie. And he said, yeah, I don't like the way black folks are portrayed in film. They're always like waiting tables or they're butlers. And I want to see something else. So he started making movies, and he made a couple really terrible movies. He went to the movies, and he's also a mathematician. So he said, how long is a movie? It said 92 minutes, 95 minutes. He said, okay, how much is 92 minutes of film? And they told him, he said, well, shit, I can do that. So he bought 92 minutes of film. He never thought about editing it. He just thought, you know, 92 minutes
right,
of film.
Right, we saved for
so
92.
His first movie, because there was mistakes, he had to edit, whittle it down, was 5 minutes long. It's like, ah, damn, he was so hot.
Lesson learned.
So he sends his little janky movie to Columbia Pictures, and they say, we don't need elevator operators. He goes, no, I want to direct. They said, yeah, we understand. We don't need elevator operators here. He sends it to France. The French love it because they love weird existential art stuff.
French film is the best. Come on.
It's like, what's
good
going
stuff,
on?
Cinema.
So he sends it there. They go, oh, this is so existential. Look at the repression. Whatever they say. French people back then. Who knows? So he goes. So he wins some award in France. This little movie.
First 5 minutes.
Yeah,
cut.
First 5. Little short film, which I'm in. He and my mom, now again, think of this now. He's 24 or 25 when I'm born. My mother's 21. They're young. Who knows anything at 21 and 24, right? So they go, let's go to Europe, dude. Let's get out of America. It's too square. They're like the original hippie beatniks, right? So they get on what's the cheap way to get to Europe? They take a boat. And it's a long-ass trip. And we go on some Titanic-type thing. We sail to Europe. I still remember it.
How old were you then?
Oh, I don't know, 4, 3.
You remember?
I remember the boat moving
oh
man, this is not good.
Do you ever go on a cruise now or a ship?
I actually have. Yeah,
okay.
And I do like it.
Okay, so you got over for that.
I got over, yeah. It's different than being in the middle of the ocean. Like, that's a different deal.
I can't imagine. I've never done a transatlantic trip, but it sounds brutal.
It's a trip. So they get to France. He wins the award, and they have no money, and that's it.
Oh, so they don't give him any money to go with the award.
No.
But just notoriety.
A big kiss on both cheeks. So he's got two wet cheeks standing in the middle of the Champs-Élysées with my mother and me and my sister. We were like, what now? No one speaks French. And he started to learn French.
That's
said, I would teach
cool,
myself
actually.
French. He learns French. He then interviews as a reporter for a magazine called Harry Carey. And he interviews a young man coming over there named Malcolm X. My father interviews Malcolm X. Years later, Michael Mann casts me to play Malcolm X. And I work with Malcolm's daughter to humanize and portray her father, not just as an icon, but as a man, as a parent. And my two daughters played two of Malcolm's daughters. So one of my daughters in real life played the woman that I was working with to play her dad, who was interviewed by my dad. It's like crazy.
That's crazy.
So it's like, who in life gets to do this kind of stuff? You know, it's like, if Dickens wrote it, I'd be like, oh, that's
right.
Not real. Come on.
Far-fetched.
That's too far-fetched. But I've gotten to do it. Like, I look at the history of my family in this country, and it's bizarro, incredible. My black granddad taught himself to read, stopped the lynching in the South, has a knife wound through his hand, where he is a big dude. He went and he stopped his lynching at 14, then went up to Chicago, eventually became a landowner there, was a tough cat, and owned a dry cleaning business and started doing pretty good. His buddy also made money. His buddy said, you know, Van Peebles, what are you going to do with your money? And he said, his friend was going to get a Cadillac. And my granddad wasn't a super materialistic cat and said, I'm going to send my son to this place called college. Changed our family dynamic. We're not tall enough to play ball. I'm not skilled enough to rap or sing. you know, and yeah. too nervous to steal, you know. So, but going through college and that changed our dynamic. My dad met my mom, who was also through college. Her father was a professor at Harvard and Howard, was German, who left Germany when this knucklehead Hitler was coming to power, and no one believed that he was a problem. No one took him seriously. They all said, this guy's a fascist, and he's using race as a divider, and he's dangerous. And my grandfather split and left, came to America and wanted to join the military to fight the Nazis. But they wouldn't let him because he had an accent. They're like, no, you look like Third
Never
Reich.
Mind we can't. That. Right.
I know your heart may be there, dude, but you no.
We can't risk it.
And so he became a budget analyst for the Truman administration, wrote several political science books, and was super educated. And my mother's mother was one of the first white women to join the NAACP. And my mother's mother, who's white, sued the Virginia school system because they were not letting her kids, who were white, go to school with Latin, Mexican kids, black kids, Jewish kids, or whatever, and say, you're denying them a full education by limiting their exposure to the world. And that's wrong. And they won, and the KKK burned a cross on my white grandmother's lawn and said, we hope your daughters marry niggers. And she said, oh, thank you, so do we. And so they were really forward thinking. So I have that side on the white side, and on the black side, taught themselves to read, you know, side.
Yeah, it's incredible, and, really. And it's an incredible family.
The roots
family.
Are pretty dope. You know, my roots are pretty fabulous in... You know, really interesting. There's a movie there.
Yeah, that's an understatement. There is a movie there. Oh. But these are like incredible people, like across the board, generation to generation.
Yeah, and my mother being this feisty, independent thinker, go-getter, you know, and my dad being like... And my dad has a lot of, you know, moxie, too. You know, when his mom, who's, you know, sort of a little well-to-do... My grandfather was the hard-working salt of the earth, my black grandfather. But his mom was a little bit more, you know, affluent and, you know, wanted to be well, you know, kept in the lifestyle that she wants to be kept in. And she told my dad, she said, what's better than marrying a wonderful black woman? And my dad said, a one-legged white woman. Just to piss her off, you know. You know,
yes.
You know what I mean? I mean, so I have, you know, they are so un-PC. You know what I mean? I mean, they just will say whatever the hell is on their mind. And they knew they needed to get out of America because they'd both gotten lynched. I mean, they were just really, you know, fun, crazy, you know, flawed people. And that was the other thing, was that my parent, I never had the luxury of looking at them as perfect people because they would so tell you anything you wanted to know. And stuff you didn't want to know.
Well, that I like
you'd,
that.
You'd be like,
I appreciate
they
that.
They were so real that you're like, oh man, too much information, yeah. Dude.
But it's good for you. This is what you're the product of that.
Yeah.
That's so not a bad thing.
Yeah, yeah. So you know, so that's kind of led to me having a humor about life that sometimes gets me in trouble. Sometimes I'm not supposed to say certain things, and I go, okay, I have to dial that down. But yeah, I've had an amazing career, and I've gotten to do things sometimes with my family and sometimes with an extended family that I really enjoy. I think there are three loves in life: love what you do, love who you do it with, and love what you say with it. And I've gotten those three to line up multiple times, and it's awesome.
Yeah, I mean, you're lucky, but also you had a hand in it as well. Like, you know what I mean? It's not just luck, you're just one of the lucky ones. I mean, there's part of that too, I'm sure. But, you know, you're coming from a solid family who passed on some traits to you and some life lessons too.
And
that's how you do it.
Yeah, and a history of speaking truth to power, from my white grandmother who sued the school system and got the school system integrated so her white kids could go to school with the world, to my black grandfather who went into the local store in Chicago and took my dad with him at 8 and pulled all the Wonder Bread off the shelves and stomped on it and said, you will not sell any bread here until you have some minority drivers in this neighborhood. And said, I'm just going to deal with one thing. You're going to hire minority drivers. He wasn't a driver. He would not benefit directly from it. But my dad saw that, and lo and behold, eventually they had to do that. And he saw that one, you know, it's that old thing of big storm comes, and all these starfish have washed up on the beach, and they're dying, and they're suffocating. And a little old man walks through, and he's throwing the starfish back in the water one by one, and a young yuppie guy comes along and says, what's that going to do? that doesn't make a difference. And he holds up a starfish. He says, to this one, it does.
Yeah.
But each one of us can make a difference. That what you order, what you drive, what you say, the energy you give out. Do you make that old lady smile? Do you learn what that little Asian kid's doing? Are you interested in what that old Jewish man is thinking? Do you follow that? So, do you talk to someone who doesn't have the same beliefs as you?
Yeah.
Do you listen and learn new stuff from people that don't look like you? Do you go outside of your box and watch that other news channel? Listen to other folks. And if you do, you'll see it and you'll understand it more. And if you, it just opens things up. So I had an example of people who didn't buy into materialism and didn't become a slave to that, but also thoroughly enjoyed laughing and shocking and bringing a little change to it.
Yeah,
and so it just meant that whatever business you were in, you would apply that.
So you are a very analytical person.
I hope, yes, but I think I'm intellectual center, as they would call it, but I think that part of it is also very feeling.
Okay, so you say you have an intellectual center, like that's your main driver.
If something were to happen, what that means is, if a big explosion happened over there, my first reaction would be, what is that explosion? What's the best way out of here? I would react to it intellectually. Some people would react emotionally and go screaming and running out.
How do you know this about yourself?
From that guy I go to.
Okay.
Yeah.
So he sort of pointed that out.
But super accurate. That's right. That I first.
And you're like, you got it.
You got it. Like first, you know, you go, oh, okay, yeah, that's right. Now I have a daughter that reacts emotionally to stuff, so it's heart first.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, oh my God! You know, she'll go there first. So I'm like, I'm cooler, and I'll think about it and say, okay, what are we going to do about that, and analyze it first. But everyone's different, and we need all of us to be different.
So you get intellectual,
but there's an emotional side. There's all those other.
So what makes you emotional? Like, what brings out your emotions?
Well, and that can be a positive and a negative. I find. You know, being disrespectful of others is if someone's disrespectful.
So when you're saying
if you went out and I were at a restaurant, and someone was super disrespectful to you for whatever reason, I would feel for you, and the man in me would probably go, "Hey, do not do that."
Empathy.
Yeah,
it's when somebody else is getting.
Yeah. But and I think especially with women, which is interesting. You know what I mean? Where I'll be like protective of my girls differently than my boys, you know, so there's a little bit, you know, and that's also interesting because you get to a double standard thing, but it is interesting. Yeah,
but you notice that about yourself.
And I'm totally okay with it, you know. I understand it. My kids may want to be different. I'll give you a case in point. Two of my boys went to Europe, and I was okay with them going to Europe, and they had worked a little bit to save a little money, and I said, find the cheapest ticket you can go to Europe. And they got a Eurail pass, and they slept in a garage. They washed up in the fountain in Italy. They bought a tent at a certain point, and they roughed it all around. I would not do that with my daughters.
Yeah.
Not on my watch.
She's going to be saying it like the Ritz in Paris or whatever.
Not necessarily the Ritz.
Okay.
But, you know.
Right, but she's going to be safe.
You know what I mean?
You're going to be safe.
You know, not going to happen.
Do you know what I mean?
I am the first one to say it. You know what I mean? No, that's not going to, you know.
Yeah.
My boys will have a different experience than them, you know what I mean? And I'm good with that. You know what I mean? And I expect them to be a little protective of their sisters and be, you know that they're going to have daughters one day, and you know, just handle that the way you want it. You want it done later, because it will come later if you live long enough. You know what I mean? So I have a sense of karmic justice that here's the thing. What I've tried to do at this point for some years is understand that I'll never be as good as the Mario I want to be. The Mario I want to be is over here. And the Mario I am is over there. But these two Negroes are in the same room.
Yes.
You know, they're not one. I'm not over here preaching something and over here, you know, molesting some little.
Yeah. I think it's good.
You got to at least get in the same room with that other person and go, hey, wait a minute. You could have done better with this. You could have done that. I'm tough on myself. So that's important. You got to get to that place. And then if you can look at the Mara you want to be and say, okay, there's wiggle room between the two of us, then you can be more forgiving with others. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. I can't look at somebody else and say, oh, I've never done that. I've never wanted to do this. I've never stolen anything. I remember trying to shoplift as a kid once. I'm glad I was not good at it. do you know what I mean?
Good thing.
But I can't say I've never done that. Do you know what I mean? I can't. Most things that people do, I of course never killed anyone, do whatever, you know, raped anyone, nothing like that. But most things you go, oh, okay, I gotta look at me first. And if you can do that, you'll be much better off, I think.
So have you always worked on yourself in this way? Like, it seems like you're constantly working on getting closer to this guy.
I suppose life is a process of that. And I think that when I go back to the feeling of things, when I talked about being able to feel things, I look back sometimes and go, oh, I was feeling something. I didn't articulate it, but I definitely felt it. One of my favorite teachers when I was at, I messed up in school and I had to go to a school with a prep school and, you know, and really work. And it was in Connecticut, it was all boys. And it was like, oh man, why am I here?
Like a military type?
Kind of, but it was.
What did you do together?
My school stuff had slumped off. And
so it's just your grades?
My grades, and my dad was not having it. And so I went to this, you know, and it really helped me. I went there for 2 years and it really helped me get my act together. And that's a long, fun story there. But anyway, so I was there. But one of my favorite teachers was this priest who taught Greek mythology. And it was awesome. Like, he taught this class, and he had such energy and charismatic to the point where I thought, man, I could be a teacher. You know, like, this guy really can lay it out. It was awesome. He also, and food was not good on campus. It was just mediocre, you know, cafeteria food. He also had this cooking class that was supposed to be spectacular. They cooked these great meals, and he had a house on the campus, and he would invite some of the special kids to his cooking class. And he would always invite me to the cooking class. And I just never went. I just never felt like going. Just the vibe was like, nah, I'm not going.
Yes.
Didn't think about it. Wasn't articulating. Years later, I'm alumni of the year. I'm graduated from this and that and the other, and I'm a little bit famous, and so they want me to be a little bit. Come back, and we do this alumni dinner, and they give me this lovely chair that says my school name on it, St. Thomas More. And one of the other guys, and everybody's grown up to be like the scary version of themselves, and you, like, you know, those reunions you go to, you're like, oh my God, so-and-so looked like they ate the couch, and somebody else looks good. You know, we all think we look good, and, you know, but whatever, because we see each other, ourselves every day. So this one guy goes up and goes, hey man, you had the priest for Greek mythology. I said, yeah. He said, you know, they'll pay for counseling if you need it. I said, what do you mean? Turned out he was molesting boys at the cooking club in his house.
Are you kidding
me? Now, I didn't articulate to myself why I didn't go, but I have had more of those situations where I just, the vibe wasn't there, dude.
So you feel something inside, and you don't know what it is.
Because if I want to intellectualize it, I would say, this is a dynamic dude. I love his teaching. He preaches the word. And I'm not a religious cat, per se. Organized religion is more spiritual than that. But something, just the vibe wasn't there. And I have a number of cases of that. And I've gone around the world. I've stayed at people's homes that I was invited to that I didn't know. And I've had people stay with me that I didn't know. And I've never had an issue. Now, that doesn't mean I won't have an issue. But there have been a couple of times when I had to get up, get my ass up and say, you know what, I'm bouncing now.
Oh, from their house? Because
whatever,
you felt something? Because you saw something at that point.
There was one situation where I said, you know what, I may be wrong, but I don't want to get pissed off. Let me just... What's the downside of me having nowhere to stay tonight? Is that I'm going to go for a long walk.
And you did that.
And that's what I did. I put my backpack together. I was 18. I looked like Michael Jackson. I said, man, this is not good. And I walked. So I have had many situations that I look back on that were about intuiting and feeling and not about intellectualizing, because there was nothing in the intellectual side of it that I would have gone, oh, that's a problem.
Yeah, but so it's like, a combination. You've got to have a combination
where you go, oh, that's, you know.
Yeah, but some people have a stronger intuition than others.
So they do. And I've had friends that just walk right into stuff and I go, no, look at the room, read the room.
Plus, the longer you, or the more experiences you end up having, the more it reinforces your intuition. Like right. that, yeah, you right. know, I know, I've right. been there, right. I get it, I see.
Yeah. By and large, if you give out a good energy, we're kind of like magnets. I think you pull some of that back in. I'm a nerd for people. Like, people are like books and novels. You can be a nerd just for paper. That's fine. That's great. You can be a little nerd online. That's cool, too. I'm a nerd for stories.
Oh, I'm one of those. That's what I am, too. That's why I do what I
That's
do.
That's what you do, what you do.
I'm fascinated by everybody.
You get to ask people questions in your work that would be pushy at a cocktail party.
Correct.
Here's the other thing. You take two people. They work out the same, eat the same, live in the same place, and one person is learning new things regularly, they're going to live longer and younger.
Well, that is, there are studies to back that up.
Because every time you learn something, you turn on, it's like that light bulb goes on, you turn on all the cells in your body. And you go, oh, wow. And you get that's it. Clint Eastwood told me when we did Heartbreak Ridge, he said, because he was 64 at the time and just great shape, and he said, part of the secret was to learn the other guy's workout. Do something new. Surprise your muscle group. Go outside your comfort zone.
And you like to do that anyway.
Absolutely.
But that's good advice for everybody, I think. And I think for a lot of people, it's hard to do that because the easier thing is the comfort zone.
The easier thing is the, well, yeah.
It seems like it, at least.
The easier thing is the comfort. I find it less interesting.
Me too. I'm not into a comfort zone. Yeah. Who wants to just be comfortable sometimes?
If you keep doing what you've been doing, you'll keep getting exactly what you've got. Yeah. And I like to say, what's that? Why are they doing this? What's this? And, you know, that's fun. Expand.
You're an interesting person.
You're an interesting person.
Well, thank you, but I guess we recognize each other, but you are an interesting person, and you're coming from so many interesting people, but you can tell that you're so interested, which makes you interesting. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I definitely know what you mean.
Totally. And are we getting the wrap-up note? Okay.
You've been so good to talk to you.
Oh, really?
Yeah, this is an unusual thing. So, yes, this is unusual. So, I'm going to give you my number afterward privately.
Yes, please. That would be great.
Text me after you see the show.
Totally going to do it. So, I'm here for a week only.
Where are you from?
I'm in New York.
What's your story? Okay, now, because I'd love to know what your story is. So, you're in New York.
Okay, I'm in New York. Okay. I'll tell you my story quickly.
Okay.
I was a therapist.
Okay.
Before I was a journalist.
Okay.
So, this is, you know, I'm so interested in people. I'm a people nerd, like you said.
That's interesting.
So, I went to Columbia, got my master's there.
Okay.
Opened up my own practice, saw people, helped people figure themselves out,
right.
Started writing, and I've been a journalist for many years. So I kind of like let go of the therapy practice and just did more of the writing,
right.
And then recently decided to start the podcast on my own. So I write. I still write for like the New York Times and a few other publications. But the podcast is the future for me because I can just sit and pick people's brains or just get to know them better.
Right.
Which I love.
That is great. And you're good with it.
It's cool.
Yeah.
Like, seriously?
Yeah. You'd be fun to talk to more. I'd be like, I'd be interested to see what she thought of this or that.
Well, let's do it then.
Yeah. Because it's interesting. Did you see Molly's Game?
No.
Okay.
You want my thoughts on it? I can't give them to you.
No. There was a scene with her dad that was really well done, I thought.
Let's flip it a second. I'm going to ask you a couple of quick questions,
sure.
And then we'll wrap up for everybody. Okay. So, best movie, your favorite movie or television show of all time?
Yeah, I'm not a best guy. You know?
Okay, it doesn't have to be best.
That's funny.
Just give me a few.
But there are ones that I like for different reasons. Now, recently, I've been enjoying television. I think that television is going through this golden age where I go, oh, whoa!
Yeah.
I wish I did that! Oh, shit, that's so dope! For example, I wasn't a Game of Thrones guy, but I watched it finally and stuck with it. There's some lines in there that are really good.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah. There's this one where this woman confesses to this monk guy that's sort of running the world now that the reason she was helping out the poor was to be seen doing it, and that really the poor disgust her. And that's her secret. She said, the poor freaking disgust me. And the guy says to her, well, of course they do, my dear. They remind us of what we would be like without soap. They remind us of how we would eat without good food. They remind us of how we would look without proper grooming. They disgust us because they are us. I was like, oh, shit. Whoa. That's dope. Right? That's yes. Some dope shit. I was like, that's in Game of Thrones? Okay. When you watch some of the episodes of Black Mirror and you go, oh, wow, that's interesting that we're getting to the place where we're all about rating and whose God has more followers than the other
yes,
God.
Yes.
Like, my God has more followers than you. Do you know what I mean?
Yes.
And you're still like, we've got a lot of friends, but we're lonely.
All right, so I have to ask you my last question, but before I do, I have one more thing. Can I just quick shout out to Bloodline?
Oh, right? Dude, Bloodline, that's another show. You know, Todd Kessler, I directed Robbery Homicide, and then I did a little of Damages for them, and then Todd asked me to come act and direct Bloodline on that, and it was just such a smart, interesting show, and I got to play. I played a character that's sort of loosely based on a sort of Sheriff Clark type guy. So fun to do.
I loved that show. I miss the Rayburns and the whole story.
Yeah, really.
So, did you direct like the last few episodes, or was that not part of yours?
The last season.
The last few of the last season? The end?
I did towards the end.
Okay, towards the end, but not the end.
Yeah.
Okay. I won't spoil it for other people, but did you watch it too? Do you have an opinion about it?
Good stuff.
I love that show.
Yeah.
Okay, so my last question. It's two parts. Who do people think Mario Van Peebles is? What's the image of you?
Oh, it's like the elephant. Right? So the blind men touch the elephant. One touches, grabs the leg and says, oh, the elephant's like a tree. The other one grabs the ear and says, no, the elephant's like paper. The other one grabs the tail and says, the elephant's like a rope. And they're all right. It's all parts of the elephant, but they're just experiencing parts. So I'll get some people go, yo, dude, I loved you in Heartbreak Ridge, man. I'm a Marine. What's up? And then I'll get some of the cats who, love Superstition or love Badass, or depending on what they saw of my work. When they collectively understand it, then I think what's fun about that is there's a difference between being recognized and being appreciated. And I found that people that see it collectively tend to appreciate it. And that's really when they go, oh, I got that. I really enjoyed how you came at this. And then sometimes it doesn't. The same guy that was in Heartbreak Ridge, you sort of had to go, oh, that's the same guy that directed and acted in Badass. The same, you know, so there's through lines. But sometimes I'll direct USS Indianapolis that I'm not acting in. And it's got Nick Cage in it. And it's, you know, it's guys in the water in World War II. And, you know, so you go, oh, that's it. So, that, you know, so it might surprise you.
Right, and then you might say, oh, wait, Mario Van Peebles?
Yeah, right. So, you know what I mean? Or, I did Roots, or I do whatever, you know. So I'll do sometimes things that people wouldn't necessarily think I would do. I like seeing characters that we understand their truths. We don't always agree with their truths, and their truths are diametrically opposed. So it makes for interesting film. You've got America that's black folks here, and Italians, and Jews, and Irish, and Asians, and we're all shaken up in this big pot called the experiment, the melting pot. And so naturally, you will get sparks. But from those sparks and conflict, you'll get great art and great music, and great folklore, and great, great Gothic American superstition.
Yes. Okay, part B of my question
is
who are you, really? Because my part A was, who do people think you are?
My dad said, if you're lucky, there will be four phases in your life, Mario. There'll be Mario who? Get me Mario. Get me a young Mario. And Mario who? So understand that gracefully, right? So am I the name they named me? Am I the race, the mixed race guy that I am? Am I a product of my time? Am I the sum of my thoughts or the sum of my deeds? Do you know what I mean? I'm not even solid. You know, I'm a lot of molecules vibrating close together, so I'm semi-permeable. Do you know what I mean? So that's a tricky... When
yes.
You say, who are you? You know, I am the entity known as Mario Van Peebles, I guess would be safe to say. But I'm also a kid that's getting a big kick out of this life. So I think I'm a dreamer. I think I'm an optimist. I think I'm also a realist. I'm a goofball. I'm a jerk. I'm a loser. I'm a winner. You know, trust yourself when all men doubt you, yet make allowances for their doubting too. Wait and not be tired by waiting, or lied about, don't deal in lies, or hated, don't give way to hating, and yet don't look too good nor talk too wise. Last verse I love is, if you can talk with the crowd, you nor lose your virtue. Walk with the kings, nor lose the common touch. If neither loving friends nor foes can hurt you, and if all men count with you, but none too much, if you can feel the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds of distance run, mean live it to your fullest. Then yours is the world and everything in it, and which is more, you'll be a man, my son.
And that says it all.
A little Kipling. Ended up with some Kipling. You can't go wrong.
You did pretty well for somebody who said that was a hard question. I think you did a pretty good job with it.
Thank you.
Mario, seriously, thank you for this.
This is fun, man. It's fun. Thank you.
Was it okay?
It was awesome. It was
okay,
really good.
Cool.
I'm gonna light a cigarette. And I don't even smoke.
That was part one of our conversation. Here's Mario and me catching up last week.
So here I am.
Right, here you are.
Here I am.
You are doing your thing. You're doing what you do best.
Yeah.
You're introducing a film with all kinds of concepts, layered for everybody to see and be entertained. It's not like you're not just like trying to hit everybody over the head with like this message necessarily. Right. If they see ARM, they're going to go on a ride with you.
They're going to go on a ride. And depending on, and ultimately it's a thriller. So if you go there with nothing on but saying, I want a mind-bending thriller that keeps you guessing, most people, you know, they watch it, they don't know what the hell's going on until, like I said, act three, and suddenly they go, oh, wow, that's what's really happening. So it's one of those films that we found that people want to watch again, because it actually, the narrative works on two levels. It works first as the movie you see first, you know, through Chief's perspective, my character's perspective, and then secondly, the narrative you see once you understand what that overlay is.
Yeah, just to back up so everybody knows.
Okay.
So we're recording this on a Sunday morning. On Saturday night was the world premiere. Am I right?
Yes,
world premiere,
correct.
Right? Okay, so it was at the Newark Film Festival.
Yep. 400-seat theater.
Spilled over into the next theater.
Correct.
Because, and then you had to actually go talk to the other people in the other theater.
Correct.
Not the one that you were sitting in and watching the film.
Correct.
A few rows ahead of me. So you talked to them because there were a lot of people. So this is the first time that people have seen it.
Correct.
Outside of, I guess, your film circles or whatever.
Yeah, little bits of here and there, but not on this level. Please.
Okay, so just a few facts about it. So there's a guy with a lot of guns. But why does he have so many guns? Why does he have all this stuff? Can you say that?
He's a collector.
Okay.
I don't know how much he really... I don't know that he really knows why he has all these weapons. But he's a collector. He's pretty... he's had an experience. He was a U.S. Marshal. So in the past, he was a U.S. Marshal. He dealt with some pretty intense situations. And he probably got used to that adrenaline rush and got used to feeling like these arms, these weapons were needed for whatever reason. Some people just collect. And I don't think I can give away more than that.
Okay, that's good. That's good enough. Also, after the movie was over, you came up and you were ready to answer some questions. And I've been to some of these things where nobody even has a question. Right. Has that ever happened to you?
Usually I make films that... people have a lot of questions.
Yeah, well, people did last night.
Right, they did last night. So I mean, from New Jack City to Posse to Badass to, you know, I make films that spark some... I don't make Revenge of the Ninja Bimbos.
Right.
To, you know, so much like that.
So, you're not going to make that? That's not your next film?
Hey, I might have to. I got to make some money again.
Right, so Q&A,
Lots of people had questions for you. I don't know how long you actually stay there, but like for a long time, going, giving really great, like in-depth, honest answers about the film and about making the film, about just your sort of life philosophies. And you have a lot of them. You are. I told you last time, you're an analytical person. You have all these like life philosophies. Mm. So where did these philosophies come from?
Huh, that's a good question. I think both my parents are sort of, my mother pointed this out, that our whole family feels they have the word, whatever the word is. So I come from a family of independent thinkers who have perspective and interesting, really interesting conversations. I should send you something at some point. I'm writing a script about my parents called Free Thinker. And, you know, so when you say, well, where did you get that from? It's, I don't know if it's something that, if it's nature versus nature, nurture, or a combination thereof.
You don't have you're not in one camp versus the other?
I don't think so. I also having kids, right? And I've got a bunch of
how
wonderful
kids. How many kids do you have?
So I've got my three big boys and two big girls. Okay. They're all different. So you kind of see that one size fits parenting doesn't really work. One size fits all parenting. It's like bathing suits. People wear different bathing suits, different top, different bottom, different, you know.
Right.
So what encourages one kid would stifle another. What inspired me, you know, with my dad, maybe intimidated my brother a little bit. You could have twins. For example, there were these twins, identical, great-looking guy twins. And they did a story on them. And their father was a gambler and a womanizer, and they always had feast or famine, and they lost all their money, and then he made some money. And one of the brothers, you know, was a gambler, and he feast or famine and lost money, made money. And the other one went into business and was sort of doing some eco-friendly business and had a lovely little family, and they're twins. They look exactly the same. They talked to the first brother that's the gambler, and he said, well, I grew up with a dad who was a gambler and a womanizer. We had money, and then we didn't have any money, so that was my role model. You go, oh, yes, that makes sense. They talked to the second brother. He goes, well, I grew up with a dad who was a gambler. We'd always make money and lose money, so, of course, that's the last thing I wanted to do, so I went into business, and you think, that makes
sense.
Totally. Right? So you have two twins. You have twins who react to the same stimulus with different souls, and so their souls react intrinsically and see a different lesson from the same stimulus.
Right. That's actually a perfect example because the parenting was the same.
The parenting was the same. So that's same genetic thing,
yes.
Same everything. So that's why I throw that out. So the one brother would say, look, this is the logic of how I am, of course. And the other one would say, no, this is the logic of how I am. So when you see that, you kind of go, oh, and then you see it in your kids. And your kids, you don't know who they're going to be. They don't necessarily know who they're going to be. They'll tell you. They'll find out. And then as a good parent, you help them be the best person that they can be, the best version of them.
Yeah.
And in your ability to help them, hopefully, that's the nurture part. But what they came in the door with, dude, that's the nature part. Your kids are born and they already have something going on. They'll already be interested in this and not that, or that and not this. You don't know.
Yeah. Totally. The minute they're born,
you're
like,
someone's
going to
cry a lot.
Right, exactly.
My mother told me I was born like I was welcome to the party. Like, hey, I'm here. Uh-huh. Let's get it started. Where's the music?
I think that is you.
And
to
that
this
is
day.
Me. You know, so you come in. I came in like happy to be here.
Right.
Like, yo, let's do this. So you probably came in going, hey, mom, what do you think about this?
Exactly. Watch Mario's new movie, Armed, in theaters and on demand. I have an extra bonus clip online with Mario diving deep into his iconic film, New Jack City. Just click on the show notes in your podcast app right now. You don't even have to press pause. To get your free week of therapy at BetterHelp, go to betterhelp.com/reallyfamous. Who do you want to hear next on the show? I'm totally curious. Reach out to me on Instagram or Twitter, or if you're not on social media, that's cool too. Just email me at reallyfamouspodcast@gmail.com. It doesn't mean I'm going to land them on the show, but we'll see. If you like Really Famous, I would be so appreciative if you want to share it with a friend, family member, colleague, anyone. Now, not everybody knows what podcasts are, but that's okay. What you can do is just send them a link to the show. You can go into your podcast app, click on that little square with the arrow shooting up. That's how you share an episode, or that's how you share the whole show. So go ahead and spread the word. It's really the best way that you can support the show. So once again, thank you for listening. Thank you for supporting Really Famous. If you want to share it with a friend, that'd be amazing.